Hi, everyone. Welcome to today's session on testing distributed systems with AJAX and XML, lessons learned from Google Checkout. I'm Jason Huggins, and I'll be presenting today with Martin Omander from the Checkout team. And let's just dive in here. So we at Google love to do everything automatically. And in particular on the Checkout team, they wanted to run automated functional tests. So first of all, why automated tests? Like, well, manual testing is just too labor intensive. It's error prone, so automation is better than millions and millions of paid interns, right? Also, why functional testing? Well, there's a great quote from Cedric Bust. I think we got the pronunciation right on that. He's a Googler, and he's also the author of the TestNG framework. And he wrote a really cool quote on his blog a little bit ago, saying, well, while unit tests have been receiving a lot of exposure these past years, functional tests are ultimately the only way to guarantee that your application works the way your customers expect. So unit tests, thanks to the Agile and XP methodologies, have gotten lots of attention. But don't forget your functional tests, because that's what your customers see. OK, so great. We want to do functional testing. Well, the problem is Checkout, in particular, like many AJAX apps, it requires workflow to be done in the browser and involves both synchronous and asynchronous HTTP posts back and forth to the server. So AJAX. Hopefully everyone knows what AJAX is. We're all here. All interested in how we test it, right? And well, the solution is to find some kind of test server that can simulate the user going into that browser and do both of those synchronous, you know, post response requests and the AJAX-y requests. So what existing tool could possibly simulate a user? Well, Selenium, of course. And fair disclosure, I'm the original author of Selenium. Created it before I became a Googler. Yeah, so my opinions here are biased. Right? So what does Selenium do? It kind of defines what it is and what it does. So first of all, it's a test automation framework. I'd like to say this is my 20% project at Google. It might be someday. These are the paid interns, right? So it's a test automation framework. And Selenium is good for a couple things. In particular, AJAX. This is a kind of one of those canonical examples when people say, hey, how do I test Google? Well, Google.com is a not an AJAX app, but Google Suggest. Has everyone seen Google Suggests as a web page? OK, raise your hands high. Has everyone seen it? OK, more than half the room. So as you type in your text, as you can see on there, as you can type in a phrase, there's AJAX calls back to the server as you're typing in each key trying to suggest what you're actually searching for. So when you type in Selenium, you might be looking for Select Comfort or Selena lyrics. I don't. Anyway, Selenium is on there. But the cool thing to know is that if we can get Selenium to test this thing, you know, it can test AJAX. The other thing Selenium is useful for is testing end-to-end workflows. This is like, you know, classic functional test. This is an example from Google Docs and Spreadsheets. And so let's say you have a scenario where you want to log in, create a document, share it with your best friends Larry and Sergey, click the Invite Collaborators button, verify that they actually can collaborate editing the document, and then log out. That kind of a scenario is great for, that's what kind of Selenium was created for, AJAX and end-to-end workflows. And also, in particular, testing those workflow scenarios in all the different browsers and all the different platforms. So when we created it, we needed to make sure that the web application that it was Selenium was testing could run in Safari and Mozilla at the time, Firefox now, and Internet Explorer on all the platforms. And since Selenium is just testing the browser, it's just HTML and JavaScript as far as it's concerned. So it doesn't matter what the server-side implementation is that generates that code, whether it's PHP or Ruby on Rails, Python, .NET, Java, it doesn't matter because it's all HTML and JavaScript. So it's browser agnostic, platform agnostic, and server side agnostic. So just kind of summing up briefly before we get to the demo, Selenium's strengths. It actually drives a real browser, and that gives you two benefits. First, you can actually test real user scenarios. And you also can test browser-specific bugs. That was actually the driving reason why Selenium was created, because bugs were showing up in Firefox or Mozilla, and not IE, and then we'd fix it, and then it would swap. And it's very frustrating trying to hammer out browser compatibility issues. Also, Selenium offers one API for all the testing browsers. So you can use the same Selenium script, relatively, to test in Firefox and IE, all the browsers. And a nice benefit of using Selenium remote control, which I'll briefly show at the end, is that there's one API for any language. So you can write your tests using a test harness in Java, C Sharp, PHP, Perl, Python, Ruby, and Selenium can run your tests. Also, we offer for the people who are a little bit fearful of programming syntax, we offer kind of an HTML table syntax for the tests, which kind of looks like an Excel spreadsheet that analysts really like. Also, two other benefits of Selenium, that it's low cost, it's actually free, doesn't cost a thing, and it's open source. So you have the freedom to tweak it, embed it, fix it if there's anything wrong with it. So let's show a couple of demos. All right, so I've got four little movies to show you, all recorded and ready to go. So first I'll actually show you one piece of technology in the Selenium family called the Selenium IDE. It's an extension for Firefox. Now, you can get it from openqa.org, but here it is. I'm just going to pause this briefly. It's just launched it on the sidebar. Here it is, right? And I'm just going to go and record a simple test of going to google.com, typing in hello world, and verifying the result. This is not an AJAX-y test, but Selenium IDE is actually good for testing non-AJAX-y interactions. So it's a playback recorder, I guess you would call it. It's like the generic term for this. So here I am just typing hello world into the search box. Sorry, competing arrows here. This is a movie, okay. So you can see that it recorded the actions right here. It clicked and waited for the page. And then actually another nice little feature of Selenium IDE, I have a context little pop-up window I can do it'll help me create some asserts. This actually makes it a real test. If you don't verify or assert anything, it's not really a test. So here I am just playing it back for you, and that went pretty fast, so I'm just gonna go a little bit slower. And you can step through each action. And when an assert passes, it goes green. Let me pause it here. Oh, darn. And if the test goes, if it doesn't pass, then it goes red. So now let's actually show something slightly different, but actually doing an AJAX kind of a test, same kind of thing. Let's go ahead and play this. So I'm kind of showing you a pre-canned script that I have. Now, one thing to know about Selenium IDE, it's actually great for recording non-AJAX-y tests, but for AJAX kinds of things, you don't always know that the recorder is not a genius, so you'll actually have to kind of stitch these together. So I actually had to kind of, so Selenium IDE is useful for creating these tests, but in this case, by hand. So let's kind of just briefly show what this test does. And this is a good example of a bad test. I'm actually gonna go to Google Suggest, type in S-E-L-E, wait for Selenium to show up, and then the slash 40 is the ASCII code for the down arrow. So I'm going to go down six times and then verify on the next page that the OpenQA site where Selenium hosted comes back. So this is a very brittle test because if Selenium moves up or down in that pop-up, the test will break, and that's probably not something that you really care about. So let me show you a better example of this same kind of test. I'm going to open the test Google Suggest Better example. Maximize this. And just briefly, we're going to do the same kind of thing. Open, we're going to type the keys. Here's one thing that kind of makes Selenium very special for AJAX testing is this wait for command. There's a whole family of wait for condition, wait for expression, all kinds of things. But what you can do is just in this case, I'm just waiting for the text Selenium to show up on screen. But you can also give it a job expression. And that's really cool for AJAX kind of interactions. You don't care what it is, but you want something to show up on screen. And Selenium will just wait around for that thing to happen. Also, further on down, I've changed the key downs to a mouse move and a mouse down and wait command. And also, you'll see that I used an XPath expression to find where Selenium was in that that pop down or list instead of going down a specific number of spots. So this makes this test less brittle than the previous one. But I had to kind of code these and figure it out by hand. And you just run this test really briefly. Kind of just step through it. If I just run it, it goes too fast. And so there's mouse move. It'll highlight that. Then actually mouse down on it, and then verifies the text. Now let me show you one more cool demo, because Selenium is not just the IDE. It's also, I want to get to the Selenium remote control. So I'm going to do one more different kind of test. I'm going to look for the phrase AJAX testing and see what comes up as the top hit in Google. So as you can see, it's very similar to the previous test. I'm going to go to Google Suggest, type in AJAX test in without the G at the end, and then wait for the text AJAX testing to come up as the suggestion. And I'm going to do the similar go to that particular link. And then I'm going to verify that actually AJAX testing with Selenium shows up on the results page. So let's show this test running. So you can try this live if you want to. But the nice thing about this is there you go. You see AJAX test in, selects AJAX testing. It goes, and surprise, surprise, a post about Selenium is the top hit for AJAX testing. So that's kind of cool. But what's cooler, actually, is in this Selenium IDE, we have this, yeah, there you go. The movie's going a little bit slower than I'm talking. The cool thing about Selenium IDE is that it lets you translate these, what we call Selenese or table tests, this kind of simple syntax, into a classical, you know, Java or Python or Ruby test that you can then more easily integrate into your build environments. So here I am going to go to the options menu, then format, select Python, and now I've just translated this into a valid Python test using the Python unit test framework. So I'm just going to go ahead and copy and paste this code into a shell that I already have running in my other desktop. So first, I'm going to start the Selenium remote control server. That's just a Java server. You can just download that from the website again. So I'm just going to start that. And now it's listening, and it's really a proxy between your Python script and the web browsers. It knows how to take the commands in the Python script and launch browsers, send it commands, things like that. So now I'll actually bring up an interactive prompt of Python and paste in that test that I just took from Selenium IDE. And I'll just click enter one more time and see what happens. So Selenium Remote Control has launched Firefox and did a little playing around here, maximize this window. And there it goes. It's going to do the same test that you saw before that I kicked off manually. Go to AJAX test in, then select AJAX testing, and then verify that the top post is what I wanted. And then Selenium Remote Control also knows how to tear down the browser, quit it, and you'll notice right there at the very end that I got an OK. That was a valid unit test. You can now automate this however you want. So that's the end of my little demos here. And let's see if I can go back to the slideshow. All right. So a couple lessons learned when using Selenium. It's very easy to write brittle tests, especially if you use the recorder. You'll want to spend the time to make them less brittle, and unfortunately, that's a manual effort often. Also, it's good to write more unit tests than functional tests. Selenium is cool, and it's what your users see. However, think of it as kind of the tip of the iceberg, like literally, you know, a metaphor, like you can't see what's underwater. When a functional test fails, you really can't tell what broke. You know that your application broke, and that would be good signal to kind of stop shipping, deploying it, you know, sending out to your customers, but it doesn't really tell you exactly which particular line of code is at fault. So that's what unit tests are for. And so when you have developers really wanting to know how do I fix the application, you really want more unit test coverage than functional test coverage. But functional test coverage is important. And it's just kind of a different spin on that, a broken Selenium test is often the symptom of a missing unit test. Percolates up to the top, and usually you don't want to see, usually a unit test should have caught that before it got all the way up to the browser. And last point, use the IDE for prototyping, but use Selenium Remote Control for real testing. And real testing, I mean like automation, repeated often. Remote Control, because it lets you write your tests in Java or any of the supported languages, gives you loops, access to loops, conditionals, higher level abstractions, you know, ability to refactor to functions, you can pull in different libraries, all those things that you can't get in that simple table syntax. And Remote Control makes it easy to integrate with any particular harness, unit test, TestNG, any kinds of things. So Martin will be continuing. I'll be passing the baton here to Martin. He'll be telling you a little bit about the checkout team and how they did their AJAX testing and a little bit of Selenium in there. Cool.
All right. Okay, thank you, Jason. My name is Martin Omander. My day job is to help large merchants integrate with Google Checkout. So I hope that none of my large merchants have problems with Google Checkout right now, because I can't help them right now. How many of you have used Google Checkout there? Okay, quarter, third. So Google Checkout, why Google Checkout first? I'll give you a little bit of background. Well, online commerce has some pretty serious problems still. There are all those merchants out there that buyers don't know which merchants are trustworthy. You have all these, as a buyer, you have all these accounts out there. You have all these accounts and usernames and passwords you have to remember, different for different merchants. Great abandonment rate of carts out there. Merchants would do a lot to get the abandonment of carts down from the current 63% it is. That's of 100 carts created, 60 and checkouts started, 63 end up not being an actual order for various reasons, because it's a long and repetitive process possibly. So we built Google Checkout to help and to improve this process and make it better both for merchants and for users, for customers. So let's hop in here. And I'll actually go and buy something with Google Checkout. So our research shows that about 37% of all online purchases start with a search. So we'll pretend we are in that 37%. Let's say we want to buy a Canon Digital Rebel camera. That's a family of Canon digital cameras. Okay, so we searched. We see all the organic search results in the middle there. We see ads on top, ads out to the right. We see, for example, out here, there is an ad out here to the right, center right, Canon Digital Rebel, buy.com. Do I have a buy.com account? Have I ever bought something from them before? I don't remember. I bought stuff from so many merchants. Do I trust buy.com? I don't know. Maybe I haven't heard about these guys before. Do I want to give them my credit card number? But because you see the Google Checkout logo on this particular ad out here, you know that if you go and buy from these guys, you don't need to give them all the information, your billing and shipping address and email and credit card and all that again and again and again. Same thing in product search. this is a type of different search that runs parallel to web search. Here you can actually see prices of products and see pictures of them. And right now I'm in a mode where only merchants who have Google checkout are displayed. So here's another one. $599.88. Wow, that sounds really good. A lot cheaper than the other guys. J&R Music and Computers. However, I don't know. I've never heard of them before. But they have Google Checkout, so it's risk-free. let's see. Okay, $1,500. Oh, and I saved $900. They have... My friends at J&R are saving me $900, so I will add this to the cart. Okay, so now time to check out, time to buy it, to actually place the order. So I can go through the normal checkout that J&R has, and I counted last night. These are actually 21 text fields I have to fill in. And then probably create yet another username and password that I have to remember, and give these guys my credit card number and my email address, which they may or may not sell to someone else. So let's not do that. Let's go back here, and we see the Google checkout. So we'll try that instead. So now we are on a Google website, and I'm asked to log into my Google account here. So let's see, momander@google.com. Let's see if I remember my password. So now we have my cart here. Here is the camera. I can choose. It looks like J&R is providing me with three different shipping methods to choose from. I've previously, when I created my Google Checkout account, I put my American Express card in there. I can have more cards in my checkout account. Right now, looks like I have my business address here, 1600 and 5th Theater Parkway. Looks like I also have my home address in here. I can add new addresses. And then I click the place order button, and I'm done. The order goes off to J&R. Google basically is telling J&R, hey, Martin bought this camera from you, ship it. Google is not giving J&R my credit card number, but instead just giving J&R the $614. Also note out here to the left, we have the keep my email address confidential. So maybe I want to keep it confidential. I don't want J&R to have my real email address. In that case, they will get an obfuscated email address that it'll be something like martin123@checkout.google.com. They'll send emails there, and then Google will forward those emails to my real email address, momander@google.com. I can also opt in or opt out of promotional emails from J&R. So it makes it a little less risky. I have more control as a consumer about what's actually happening here in the transaction. But it's also, so for me as a buyer, it's convenience, right? I didn't have to fill in those 21 text fields. I'm protected against fraud because the Google, credit card number stays with Google, doesn't go out to all kinds of merchants out there on the web, and security. Merchants are giving up a little bit of control, as we saw here. They can't force you into subscribing to their emails. They may not even get your real email address. So what are merchants getting? Well, they're getting more leads, because when you have that badge, those ads where the checkout badge were displayed tend to get clicked on more often, because people trust it. They know they don't have to give out their credit card number. More conversions. Instead of going through three pages of filling out a bunch of text fields, it was one or two pages. And all my addresses were on there already. So there are fewer people falling off and abandoning the checkout in the middle of the process. Oh, and free processing. So if you have AdWords, you get free credit card processing. And also, so you get 10x your AdWords spend in free credit card processing. Also, we saw that AdWords and checkout work well together. So the thinking is that you have, I mean, most merchants are AdWords users, customers today. You have your AdWords ads, they drive more traffic, you get more conversions, more leads, that leads more conversions, you can plow that back into getting more traffic, et cetera. And I should mention two promotions as well. For you, developers, there are bonuses for you if you integrate your merchants with Google Checkout, because we want you to do that. Also, regardless of whether you are an AdWords customer or not, for the rest of this year, credit card processing is free. So if you have $100 order, someone buys that, then the merchant actually gets exactly $100, not $100 minus a couple of percent that is processing. So that was the sort of marketing overview of checkout. Now let's get down to the nitty-gritty of technology. How do I integrate this with my website? So a couple of options, easy way, copy-paste a snippet of JavaScript. That gives you a very primitive checkout integration where you can only put one item, you can only sell one item at a time, but it's easy to do. You can use an e-commerce provider, like Miva Shopping Cart is integrated with checkout, so you tick a box and you're done. E-Junkie is another one I'll show you a little bit later that's integrated. We have a bunch of these who are integrated. For the developer or the merchant who is not very tech savvy, we have the HTML name value pair. Basically, you create a hidden form on your website. And then for the more advanced merchants, we have the XML API. And that's what we find most the savvy merchants use. Because with this, you can automate the whole process. So the XML API is Google and the merchant posting XML to each other over HTTP. It's we have an XML schema for that. Synchronous and asynchronous calls. So it's let's see, synchronous and asynchronous calls. We also have sample code for a bunch of different environments: Java, .NET, Perl, PHP, etc. So what would an actual transaction look like? First off, we have the merchant is out here to the left, is posting the cart to Google. So this is an XML document that's formatted according to an XML schema that we've published. This contains the cart XML, contains what items were in there. So my Canon Digital Rebel camera was in there. What special restrictions there are, possibly taxes. Google Checkout can then make real-time callbacks while the user is still on the Google website. Google can make real-time callbacks saying that, hey, the user just typed in Amphitheater Parkway as his address. What's your tax for sales tax for Mountain View, California? Or what's your what shipping methods do you have for Mountain View, California? And then the merchant can return calls in real time and they will show up in an AJAX-y kind of way in the user interface we just saw. So once the order is placed, then there will be Google will send notifications to the merchant every time the order something about the order changes, like it's canceled or and then the merchant will be able to send commands to Google about the order, like cancel this order or I shipped this order, please notify the customer I shipped it, or I've shipped it. I now want you to actually charge the user's credit card number, credit card. And we're all developers, or most of us. How many are developers here? All right, good, good. Happy to hear that. So let's look at some code. Here's some code using, so first off, let me back up and say that XML sending and parsing XML is messy if you have to do it yourself. So we built a sample code that sort of abstracts away a lot of that XML messiness. So here we have a merchant who wants to post a cart. First off, he reads his merchant ID and key from a file, for example. Typically, merchants keep it on file. Then you would create a checkout shopping cart request. That's an object that is a request that's ready to go off to Google. This is we're in the process now where I'm on the JNR's website, if you recall. I've just clicked the Google checkout button. And then this is the kind of code that would execute. So the merchant then adds a number of items with calling the add item method on this cart object. In this case, the name of the product is biscuit, and yummy biscuit is the description. It costs $9.99, quantity 2. So JNR called the add item method and put my Canon Digital Rebel camera into the cart object with such a call. Let's say we have a shipping method, USPS ground, that only goes to California. We would create a shipping restrictions object, say that this is only good for California, add allowed state code. And then we can say that the cart, we add a flat rate shipping method. It's called this, it's $3.99, and we put the shipping restrictions object in there just so that Google now knows that USPS ground is only good for California customers. Then we have taxes. Let's say this biscuit merchant is in California, so he wants to charge 8.3% sales tax in California, but no tax for the rest of the US. It would create a tax area object, add the state code CA to it for California, and add a tax rule to the cart object saying that it's 8.3% for this tax area. And let's see, the true there, I think, means that shipping should be taxed. Some merchants charge tax on shipping and others don't. Then here's a lot of magic happening here with when you actually invoke the send method. When you invoke the merchant server here is invoking the send method on the cart object, all of this is serialized into a huge blob of XML that has all these business rules we put in about tax and shipping and put the items, and actually sends that XML off to Google and processes the response that comes back, which is another huge blob of XML. Let's see, we get the C response here, checkout response, and that object will have a redirect URL in it. So Google is now saying, okay, we understand, we got the cart, we got the items, we got the business rules for the cart. Now please redirect the user to this URL, and this is where the user will now wind up on the checkout page. So this is great. We can post carts. There's similar code for processing the callbacks, similar code for processing, for sending commands to Google, please charge this order, please cancel this order, that sort of thing. But it is fairly tricky to test. Because here you have a user who has to click through a browser to do certain things. Then you have calls made to Google, responses come back from Google. Asynchronously, you may want to, if you want to test the complete lifecycle of an order, you probably want to simulate on your side that the order is fulfilled. And then you want to turn around to Google and say, hey, please charge this order. You want to make sure Google charges it, you want to make sure the response, the confirmation you get back that it is charged, is processed on your side as well. So we have synchronous calls, asynchronous calls, and user interaction, which means that usually to test this, the technology that's usually applied to this is a room full of interns. But this is not really scalable, as we found out. And it's certainly not scalable for merchants who may not have rooms and rooms full of interns. So we built a test server that we call Mendoza. that help us test checkout. So whenever we roll out a new version, we can run through a couple of hundred test cases, functional test cases, end-to-end test cases, to make sure that we didn't break anything in checkout. As it happens, we realize this is quite useful for people outside Google as well. Merchants, yourself, helping merchants integrate with Google Checkout. So we're making it open source and putting it out there, hoping that merchants will use it and will see good, rock-solid checkout integrations. So what it is, right, it is a proxy that sits between you, the merchant, and us, checkout. And it intercepts all the messages sent back and forth and verifies the semantics and syntax going both ways. So if you send badly formatted XML to Google, it will know. If Google doesn't respond with what's expected, it will know. And then the thinking is that you should be able to, after days worth of coding, you should be able to hit the test key, go home. When you come back the next morning, all your 100 test cases have run, and you'll know exactly which ones you broke and which ones are still working since the last version of your code. And it has user interaction, so that's where Selenium comes in. Selenium is now a part of Mendoza. Mendoza uses Selenium. So our order flow with this test server Mendoza is a little bit different. The merchant still posts the cart, but the Mendoza sits there in the middle. The merchant posts to Mendoza, not to the Google test environment. And then Mendoza just forwards that request. After validating it's okay, forwards it to Google. Same thing, all the callbacks going back, they go through Mendoza. And if there is any clicking involved of, you know, you want to test the user, enter, I don't know, a Puerto Rico address, and you only ship to the lower 48 states, for example, you can tell Mendoza to script that sort of, to pretend it's a user, simulate a user, and enter a Puerto Rican address, for example. So let's take a look what we can do here with Mendoza. Okay, so Mendoza is a Java server that we're starting here. Run test server. So it's a process you would start if you're a merchant. You would have your own test server where you download the jar and you run the Mendoza on it. Then, and I better explain this. Here we have OS Commerce. That's open source commerce. Maybe you've heard about it. How many have heard of OS Commerce? Okay. So for those of you who haven't, it's an open source web storefront. And what we're doing here is we are testing our OS Commerce integration with Google Checkout. So we're going into the Google Checkout module of OS Commerce. We are saying to it, we're telling it to post it, instead of posting it to the Google, normal Google sandbox environment, the Google test environment, we're telling Open OS Commerce to post to Mendoza, another URL. Here we are with the test server, Mendoza. The test server has a UI, although typically you would only use this for setting up your tests and making sure they work the first time. Because the whole point of this is not that you have to click through another bunch of tests, but you should just be able to script this and leave it overnight, and it runs its 200 tests overnight. But that would be a really boring demo if I clicked one button and then we came back a couple of hours later and it was all green. So instead, we're actually going through the UI of Mendoza. Here we are see that no commands have gone through Mendoza's command log yet. Remember, it sits between OS Commerce and the merchant. So now we're back in OS Commerce. We're going to place an order. the cart will actually go off now to Mendoza and not to, there it went, and not to Google checkout. And I hope that we'll see some refreshed status here. So there's the cart, the encoded cart at the top, and at the bottom is the plain cart, the unencoded cart XML. That this is, again, OS Commerce now sent this to Mendoza. Mendoza will, in a minute, forward it to Google Checkout and analyze the response. Yeah, it's messy. Lots of XML. You don't want to compose that by using normal string concatenations. So we're back in Mendoza. We're telling Mendoza that you should log in as whatever this username and password are up here. This is a way of telling Mendoza that, hey, you should use the, when you pretend to be a user, please use address with this ID. This is an ID that, this might be the Puerto Rican address, for example, for this test case. We click place order. Mendoza has now placed the order, or I should say Mendoza will start placing the order. Mendoza will tell Selenium to, hey, please go and pretend to be a user. And Selenium will fire up a browser here in a minute. Worth noting, by the way, that functional tests are typically pretty slow, as you see here. So you wouldn't run this, like unit tests you would run after every build, right? But these sorts of things are more of click the button, go home, sleep, come back next morning, see that the test came out okay. It's still thinking about it, driving the browser. So here's the Selenium window. Here's where Selenium pretends to be a user. Oops. Hitting sandbox.google.com, as you see. There are two environments for Google Checkout. One is the sandbox environment, when you place orders there, no money changes hands. Okay, so now this is the Selenium driving right now, pretending to be a user. We see that we're buying Duke is the mascot Java programming language. Okay, we're buying something like that. Selenium will now fill in email and password, pretend to log in. Selenium has finally logged in. And then Selenium would click the place order button here, and we'll skip out of this because we're running a little low on time here, but then all the communications go back and forth between Checkout and the merchant. Selenium sits there in the middle and approves everything. So some of the things we are working on now, and that you can work on because it's open source, everybody's welcome, is that we obviously need to improve the UI a bit here. It was fairly raw and rough. We need to incorporate this, put it together with other testing harnesses so that you actually can do what I just talked about, click a button, go home, and have all the tests run overnight. Test suites. Performance testing is also something we're working on including. Okay, so if you only remember three things from what we talked about here, I want them to be these three things. One, Selenium is great for AJAX testing. It's hard to test AJAX-y stuff, as I'm sure you all know. Two, Mendoza is great for checkout integration testing. If you integrate merchants, see if you can use Mendoza. It will cut down on the number of rooms full of interns you'll need to use. And three, integrate with Google Checkout. You get increased click-through rates, more traffic as a merchant, free processing. There are incentive programs for you developers, sample code. And we have quite a few people doing this. We have thousands of merchants, millions of customers using Google Checkout. We also are beginning to see the whole checkout ecosystem build up, which is really exciting. For example, in the old world of integrating systems, you would buy a piece of software or code and download it to your machine and put it on there and try it out. And if you're a merchant and you would, for example, need to calculate taxes, that's hard to do right. But we're seeing as part of this, together with checkout, you can use other parts of the ecosystem. Like we have strikeiron.com, which is a collection of thousands of web services in one spot. I just did a search for that last night for sales tax, and I think there were four different web services showed up. And we have Dave here. Could you stand up so people know who you are? And please come and talk to Dave if you're interested in web services to hook up with your integrations. You have some cards there?
Yeah. Afterwards, I'll just stand at the door. Basically, I've got cards that have lists of different types of commercial data that you can match up with, Google Checkout or other spreadsheets or calendar, et cetera. And it's commercial data APIs that we support and provide SLA for and all that sort of stuff. So I'll be at the door. And specifically, we're giving away a promotion here today where we'll give you a few months' worth of free sales tax data if you'd like to add that to your checkout. So I'll be at the door. Thank you very much.
All right. Another really cool thing we've seen recently, a part of this ecosystem, is ejunkie.com. Really like this. This allows you to do something that is not possible today with only checkout. Just copy and paste JavaScript into your page, into your normal HTML page, and boom, you have a checkout enabled cart. Do I have Robin here? Ah, hey. So, which one?
Right here.
Oh, right. So,
tell them that you'll be in the checkout booth.
Yeah. As Martin pointed out, eJunkie basically provides you a shopping cart that works with Google Checkout. And it really simplifies the process to a few lines of code. So that's basically what it does. You don't have to install anything, and just add your product in our interface. It will give you the necessary code you need to paste in your website, and boom, that's it. You're done. So I'll be at the checkout booth later if you have any questions and if you need my card, and that's it.
Thanks. Great. So we want more things here in this ecosystem. StrikeIron, eJunkie, very cool things that help you build your applications. We want to build up this ecosystem more and more, make it easier and easier to build applications. That's it. Thank you for your time.